Thank you. Welcome to Central United Methodist Church, a community for Christ in the center of the city. Located in downtown Asheville and online at centralumc.org. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, Easter people. My name is Mary Brown. I serve as senior pastor here at Central United Methodist Church, a community for Christ in the center of the city that welcomes everyone without exception. And it is indeed still Easter. Easter is such a big deal that we'll keep celebrating it for many weeks, and I'm glad that you're part of that continuing celebration today. We've got good folks here in the sanctuary with us, also good folks online. At the first service at 8:45, we had some of those online folks join and become official members. So if you're watching from the other side of the camera, we want to know, we know you're real people out there, and we're glad that you're part of our worshiping body today. And whether you're online or here live and in person, we want you to be prepared to participate with us. This is not a show you're going to watch. It's not a performance that you're here to attend. We are actively worshiping together. To that end, I hope you've all received a bulletin as you came in. That's your cheat sheet to follow along and actively pray, listen, praise, celebrate with us. Online, there's a bulletin for you that you can find at the link on your screen. We also, online for you, have your own attendance pad. If you follow that link, go to our worship page. You'll find a big icon where you can sign in and make yourself known. Here in the sanctuary, there are attendance pads toward the center aisle. We hope you'll all take a moment and sign in and use that if you need to update any contact information for us, because we very much want to stay in touch with you throughout the week. Each week we send out an email that gives you a heads up about events coming up. I'm about to highlight a few, but there are so many good things going on in our church. We can't name them all, so we want you to stay informed about ways that you can continue in the spirit of worship all 7 days of the week. So today at 1 o'clock, we have an ad board meeting. Our administrative board brings together the finance, trustees, staff pastor parish, or HR, committees in our church, and also has representatives from all our programming ministries. It's a way for us to align ourselves around a vision, and we meet once a quarter. So that will take place today at 1. If you serve on administrative board, this is your reminder, but anyone is welcome to attend. It'll be in the chapel right out here. Next week, we will celebrate Earth Day here in worship. And all around here on Church Street. All three of the churches on Church Street, First Presbyterian and Trinity Episcopal, are doing special things for Earth Day, so there will be an opportunity for you to wander across the street and find activities that are of interest to you. Here at Central during the Sunday school hour, Anna Alsobrook will be speaking in the fellowship hall about plastics and the environment. I don't know about you, but when it comes to caring for creation, it's complicated and I need all the help I can get. So we hope that on Earth Day, we not only give thanks for creation, but also make some commitments as to what we can do to create a positive impact. To that end, if you come back next week, we're going to have a blessing of the recycling bins. Please do not bring your recycling bin. No. Instead, we'll have many of these stickers. We'll have them up front. There will be a time in the church service where if you want to commit yourself, having thought about why we recycle and what it means in terms of our faith, you can take one of these, or several if you need it, and put it on your recycling bins at home. Particularly if they sit out at the street, it might serve as a witness to why you recycle. So come back next week for all sorts of Earth Day things, and we'll celebrate together. A final thing to highlight is we will be offering a new to Central class during the Sunday school hour in May. This class is for anyone, old or new to Central, who's curious about, for example, what it means to be Methodist. How is our church leadership structured? How do I find my way around the church, and what floor am I on, really? The answers to all these questions and more come to you over the course of 4 weeks, and this session, our own Luke Lingle will be leading it. So if you've been attending for a while and you're interested in joining, or you just want to learn more about Central, mark that on your calendar. Use the information in your bulletin to send Luke or our office an email so that we know to be on the lookout for you. That's enough business for now, don't you think? Now it's time to turn our hearts to the real order for the day, and that's to worship, to experience a little slice of eternal life during this hour together. Really tapping into that takes a little effort on our parts because there is a lot nagging at our monkey minds. I'm sure there are things on the week behind that are still clamoring for attention in your brain, or things in the week ahead that are threatening to worry you. But our God is big enough to hold all those things for this 1 hour. So for 1 hour, let's do our best to be fully present here. A great step toward that end can be to physically open your Bible and be ready to follow along. For me, that helps to focus my attention. There are Bibles in the pews. If you're watching online, opening a Bible and laying it in front of you can help make your home more of a worship space. If you use your Bible on your phone, that's fine too. Our scriptures for today are from Luke chapter 24 and then 1 Corinthians 13. So please be ready to actively listen to the word of God with us today. In just a moment, the acolytes will come and light the candles on the altar. And that's not just because they look beautiful. It's because it reminds us of the presence of the Holy Spirit with us, just as the Holy Spirit first showed up to the disciples in tongues of fire. God is here. God is there with you. God is the essential component of our worship experience. And with that in mind, as the chimes of the Trinity ring, may they call our full attention to our God who is with us in all ways, in all times, in all places.
Thank you. name of the Lord Jesus Christ, who is risen, who calls us to worship this day and every day. Please join me in praying through the words found in your bulletin. He is risen. He is risen indeed. This is the good news. He is risen indeed. Christ died and was buried, but on the third day, he is risen indeed. Amen and amen. Please stand as you are comfortable and join us in singing hymn 318, Christ is Alive.
Seated. Our first scripture lesson is found on page 214 in the New Testament portion of your pew Bible. We will be reading from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 8. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I have proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he had appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. Friends, this is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Come in with many loves. this joyous season of Easter, our lives go on. Perhaps your joy is magnified by other things that are going on in your life, and that's great, and that is to be praised. Perhaps, though, there are some things that are happening that are a little harder to bear, some struggles that are going on amidst the joy, and those two things can exist at the same time. The nice thing, though, is that in all of those places, we have a community of prayer here at Central. Every week we invite you to submit your prayer requests, to tell us about your joys, to tell us about the things that you're struggling with, so that we can pray alongside you and be in community with you. And if things are especially hard, we also have a Stephen ministry, ministry here that is able to pair you up with someone that can walk alongside you in those struggles if you need a little extra help. All of the requests come to me. You can also let me know if Stephen Ministry is something for you. You can let us know online as well. So online and together here, let's pray together. Loving God, you are beautiful and holy, light that extinguishes darkness, source of all goodness and life. Your being is the essence of relationship, one and three and three and one. And your love overflows to all you have created and are creating. Made in your image, we have the joy of giving back to you and to each other the love that you give to us. At our best, we humans act in ways that show your care for the world and all who live in it. Everyone without exception. We can only be at our best with your help. So we pray that your spirit will work in each of us so that we may grow in spirit and in faith together. For in our frail humanity, there are times we allow fear and doubts to manipulate our trust. And before we know it, we find ourselves convinced that you operate in the same way that the world does. So we strive to earn your love. We drown in guilt from our shortcomings. We believe that we are unforgivable and unworthy. We may even ascribe our pain and suffering as divine justice, when all the while, loving Creator, it is your grace and forgiveness that are as close as our next breath. Forgive us for our lack of faith in your true self, for thinking that you are distant, when in fact your Son embodied your great yearning to be with your children. For it is when we remember who you have revealed yourself to be, we are able to lay our pain and suffering and shortcomings and guilt at your feet. When we choose to let you in to heal and comfort and support us, we can draw upon your sustaining strength and love, and we are drawn to follow your way. Show your children then how we can live so that all the world will know your redeeming love and forgiveness is intended for them. Teach us as your church and open our minds to understand your word so that we may be your hands and feet. Help us to share your comfort and peace in places of grief and loss. Let us be examples of your unconditional acceptance and inclusion to anyone who feels excluded or somehow different. Show us how to feed folks who are hungry, how to give shelter to folks without a safe place to stay. Help us to reflect your goodness and love in all the ways we haven't thought of yet, so that your kingdom will be the norm instead of the exception. All these things we ask in the name of the risen Christ, who taught all the disciples to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
may be seated. Our gospel lesson this morning comes from the book of Luke in chapter 24, right after the disciples are talking amongst themselves in the days after the resurrection, just wondering, incredulous about what just happened. Hear these words. While they were talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. Yet for all their joy, they were still disbelieving and wondering. And he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written, that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all the nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses to these things." The word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
At this time, I would like to invite our children forward. Good morning.
Hello.
Hello, friends. How's everyone doing today? Yeah, I've got some new little friends here. I love it. Some lovies. Yeah. It is. So we just heard the scripture read. And last week we also heard a story, a scripture, and a sermon. And Patrick talked about Thomas and how he didn't believe Jesus until he saw the hands in his, the scars in his hands and on his side. And then today in our scripture we hear about how the disciples were frightened. And they wanted to see the scars in Jesus' hand and his side. And do you know what those scars were from? The nails, yeah, from the cross. So a couple weeks ago was Easter. And we celebrated how God made Jesus alive again. And then Jesus reappeared to people. And they were so shocked. And it reminded me of a story from when I was a kid that I'm going to share with you. I was in middle school. I was on my youth group winter retreat. I was in, I think, seventh grade. And we had a free afternoon on Saturday. We were up in the mountains of Boone, and there was an option to either go to the movies or to go snow tubing. And so most people wanted to go snow tubing, but it was kind of warm that day. And I said, I don't really want to go snow tubing when it's warm. So I went with the group to the movies. But I wished I had gone to the group that had been snow tubing because of the experience that they had. One of my friends, his name is Kyle. And if you've ever been snow tubing when it's a little too warm, it's not really snow as much as it is ice. And they had pushed a bunch of snow at the end of one of the runs down so that it would stop people. Well, my friend was a little bit lighter weight than he probably should have been for a tube by himself. And he went down the hill, and the part that was supposed to stop him actually didn't stop him, but projected him up into the air. And he flew up, and he landed over the fence. I know. He was okay. He hurt himself a little bit, and they had to take him to the doctor, and he had to have a few stitches put into his arm.
Better stitches than broken bones.
That's true. Better than broken bones, for sure. So they show up at dinner, and those of us who had gone to the movie, we hadn't heard what had happened yet. You know, this was, most of us didn't have cell phones. And so we were sitting there, and they all run in, and they're going to be like, "You are not going to believe what happened." And of course, as the story is being told, Kyle, instead of just kind of jumping over, he flew 50 feet into the air, and then it was 100 feet, and then everyone kept adding all these parts to the story, like, oh, his arms flew up, and we thought he was flying, all these silly parts of the story that kept those of us who weren't there from going. We were thinking, did this really happen? We weren't there. We didn't see it. I don't know if this really happened. And we said, "Well, where's Kyle?" They said, "Oh, he's at the doctor. He's actually going to be back in about 30 minutes. He'll be okay." And when he came back, those of us who didn't see it happen, we ran up to him. And can you imagine what we asked him? Yeah, what happened? Tell us what happened. Did it really happen to you? And there was another kid in the youth group who said, "I don't know if it really happened." And he said, "Well," and he rolled his sleeve up, and sure enough, on his arm, we saw the stitches, we saw the injury that he had received from that flight he took in the air. And a lot of the people who didn't really believe what had happened to him saw this and said, "You know what? Something happened to you. We weren't there, we didn't see it, but we know something happened. We know it was serious enough for everybody to be talking about it." And that's kind of what happened. Jesus comes back. God brings Jesus back from the dead. Jesus is alive again. And so many people were like, "Let me see your scars. Let me know that it's you," because they just couldn't believe it. But they did. And Jesus continued to teach the disciples and those who would listen so many more things for weeks to come, before Jesus eventually went to heaven. So there are so many ways that we can experience God, so many ways that we can think about the lessons that Jesus teaches us, and maybe it's a little unbelievable, maybe it's a little bit interesting to hear the stories from other people, but it's important things to share, important things to study, and important things to learn. So I encourage us this week to just pay attention to the ways that we see, oh, this is my microphone. Yeah. To pay attention to the different ways that we are still learning the lessons from Jesus. So friends, I'm going to invite us into a time of prayer, and I invite everyone here today with me this morning, either online or in person, to repeat after me. You ready? Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For Jesus.
For Jesus.
And for all.
And for all.
He teaches us.
Amen.
Amen. All right, friends, there are a few options of what you can do. You can either go sit back with your people, or you can go out that door with me and our nursery workers and Miss Meredith to either go to the nursery, or you can go to children's church if you're up to fifth grade.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Friends, preaching a sermon is a tricky thing, not something I would attempt to do without prayer. Do you know what else is hard? Listening to a sermon. I've tried that a few times too, and I think that needs prayer as well. And so I invite you to pray not just for me, but with me as we turn to God together. Come, Holy Spirit, and be present here. In us, among us, around us. Unite our hearts together. Ground us in the love of Christ, received and given. Amen. Well, I said it at the beginning of the service. I'll say it again. Worth repeating. Happy Easter. And I know Easter was a couple weeks ago, but as I mentioned, Easter is such a big deal that in the life of the church, we keep on celebrating it. 6 weeks of Easter Sundays is what we have in total. And I'm glad. I'm glad that last week, while I was gone on vacation, Patrick kept the Easter celebration going by continuing the story on. And I'm glad not just because it bears continuing, but on Easter Sunday, if you were with us, we looked at the Gospel of Mark and that original ending, whether it was intended or unintended, it ended with a cliffhanger, with the women running from the tomb, afraid and saying nothing to anyone. But thankfully, the story doesn't end there. It goes on with Jesus showing up to the disciples and doubting Thomas. It goes on with a lot of appearances, actually. All throughout the New Testament, we get accounts of Jesus, the resurrected Jesus, appearing to people. And today's scripture is one of them. It happens so often, it almost seems redundant, like, do we need to hear it again? But it's pretty amazing, right? It's a story worth hearing again. How Jesus shows up, and yet again the disciples are afraid. Is it a ghost? And Jesus says, not a ghost. Look, you can touch me and see me and feel me. In fact, I'm so much not a ghost, I'm hungry, just like normal people are hungry. Give me something to eat. And this resurrection story, these appearances, are told to us so many times because, as Paul says, it's first and foremost in our faith. It's why we're here, whether we're conscious of it or not, because Jesus died and was buried and was risen. He was risen from the dead, like for real risen. And because this story is so central to our faith, it's pretty important to understand what it is and what it's not. This is not, for example, a ghost story. Like, think of a ghost story, you know. Well, a really famous one was a movie that came out in 1990, Ghost. Anyone see that movie or remember that movie? It was the number one box office hit that year. And so even though I was in middle school and my parents would not let me see the movie Ghost, which is probably a smart move, I still was well aware of the plot. I knew, and maybe y'all remember, having seen it or not, this is a movie starring Patrick Swayze, where he's murdered, but after his death, he's able to come back as a ghost and reappear to his girlfriend, played by Demi Moore. But she can't see him at first. There's this struggle to make himself aware to her. So he has to work through a medium. He does things like levitating pennies, passing along secret code language to her through Whoopi Goldberg, who plays the medium. Now, it's no surprise that this movie captured our imaginations as a culture, because for anyone who's lost a loved one, wouldn't we love to hear back from them beyond the grave somehow? I mean, for those that I've lost, I'll take anything. A levitating coin sounds great to me. Anything that's some sign, some message from beyond. And that kind of story captivates us not just today, but certainly it did in the ancient Near East. In that day and age when Jesus lived, it was kind of an assumption, maybe even more so than today, that this was possible. That people would sometimes receive visions or dreams or even see ghosts from people who had already died. The biblical scholar and bishop, N.T. Wright, he notes that while this was common, the language people would use to describe these visions or dreams or ghosts did not include the word resurrection. What happens in Jesus is different. It is not a ghost. It's not some kind of apparition. And that's why repeatedly in the resurrection stories, we get this physical evidence. Touch me, see, I have a real body. I am resurrected. This is a whole new thing that God is doing. Which brings us to another kind of story that this is not. You know, sometimes we get stories that repeat themselves. It's like they just get kind of told over and over in various forms. Or we might see a sequel to a movie we loved and go to see it, and it's good, but we think, well, it's just kind of the same thing over again. Have you ever seen a movie like that? This happened actually right around the time that Ghost came out. There was another movie that was very popular that year, and it was called Home Alone. Has anyone seen Home Alone? It's become kind of a Christmas movie in our culture. Home Alone is the story of a young Kevin McAllister who gets left behind accidentally by his family. And while he's alone, he has to fend for himself like a little adult. And all of this gets a little bit of tension and some comedy when two bungling burglars try to get him. Now, 2 years later, after Home Alone came out, Home Alone 2 hit the theaters. And do you know what that's about? Young Kevin McAllister, who is left behind by his family, and he has to fend for himself like a little adult. And all of this has made more dramatic with a little bit of comedy because of two bungling burglars. It is the same movie, just in a different location. Now, that didn't discourage box office goers. Home Alone 2 was still a big hit. But, you know, when you watch a movie that you've essentially already seen before, it's not quite as satisfying as the first. The resurrection story is not one of those movies. It's a whole new thing. It's consistent with Scripture. As you go back and reread the Old Testament, as many of the New Testament writers did, they could see, oh, little traces. Yes, this is right in line with what God intended to do. And yet, it's this whole new thing, a new covenant, a new commandment, a new thing that happens with the resurrection that kicks off an era of this story that makes us want to live and relive it our whole lives long. And there are some stories that we don't want to relive. We don't want to hear them again. And most often in my experience, it's not necessarily because they're a bad story. It's because the ending was really unsatisfying. Like the ending kind of made the whole story itself pointless. Now, very famously, right around these early 90s, when Ghost and Home Alone came out, there was a TV show that became infamous for this called Twin Peaks. Anyone watch Twin Peaks? Not many of you. Yeah, a few of you. And at the end, I mean, I won't spoil it, but at the end, it left all the viewers kind of feeling like that resolved nothing. Now, I didn't watch Twin Peaks. I was a little young for that. My story with that was Lost. This is a TV show that came out in the early 2000s, and I loved Lost because I love a good mystery. And Lost was full of mysteries. It was a story all about this airline flight, Oceanic Flight 815, that had crash-landed on a really weird island where they kept finding really weird stuff happening. Hurley keeps repeating this number, and there's this bunker. What is the bunker? And then there's the Dharma Initiative. What's the Dharma Initiative? And then you see this statue where it has four toes instead of five. What is that? Like, that is just the tip of the iceberg of all the mysteries on this weird island that they landed on. And every episode made us like salivate for answers. And I think what added to this is that Lost came out in kind of a magical time in TV that was just a tick before streaming, just a tick before we were all recording shows and watching them at our convenience. So my friends and I got together and physically sat in a room crowded in someone's basement to watch Lost every week at the same time. And every time there was a commercial break, we'd put it on mute and debate, like, what was that? Can you believe what's happening? What's going to happen next? And always at the commercial break, someone would say, and we only have 15 minutes left. There's not enough time to answer all the questions. And as the show went on, this became more intense. There's only one season left. There's not enough time to answer all the questions. There's only 3 episodes left. 2 episodes left. The last episode. Can they answer all the questions? And by this point, our group had multiplied. There was a bunch of us packed into the basement, sitting on the edge of our seats, if we were lucky enough to have a seat, and waiting to find out, what was this all about? What was the source of all these mysteries on the island? And then, in the end, was it all just in the imagination of the main character? Was it all just what was going on in his brain as he was dying and coming to terms with death? Maybe? It's basically what the whole series finale insinuated. And it came to a close, and we looked at each other, and we were left confused. If it was all just in his head, what was the point of all of it? Now, it's still a good story. And I don't mind being along for the ride for all those years watching Lost, but it's not a story I'm going to watch again. And that thought has occurred to me. I mean, now you can just kind of stream things anywhere, and I thought maybe this would be a show that, like, the kids and Alan and I would watch together, but now that I know it's all kind of pointless, I'm not as interested in the mystery. The resurrection is not that kind of story. Maybe it would be if Jesus showed up afterward, a ghost, just kind of in spirit form. But that is not what happened. This amazing, new, never-before-done thing happened, where God died in human form and then raised from the dead in a new body, and appeared to the disciples over and over, see me, touch me, feel me, I'm real. And that invites us into a story that is worth living and reliving. It invites us into a story where everything that happened before very much has meaning, because God's not going to just wipe all this out. The God who created the whole world from the mountaintops to the oceans in intricate, amazing detail, God isn't going to just wipe all that out one day. The God who knit our bodies together in our mother's wombs isn't going to just let us abandon ship one day, like, well, that was all for nothing. No, this life matters. The way we care for creation matters. The way we inhabit these physical bodies matters. The way we attend to the physical needs of our neighbors, it matters. And also, resurrection gives us perpetual hope that as much as all this matters, we also don't have to crumble under the weight of responsibility. that when we fall short in caring for creation, when we fail to live lives worthy of these beautiful bodies, when we fail to meet the physical needs of everyone, God doesn't then say, oh no, too bad. No, our God is a resurrection God who can breathe life into dry bones, who can raise up new and perfect bodies. And I don't know exactly how that works, but I know that all those disciples who saw Jesus, a physically risen Jesus, this is what they're pointing to. This is the Easter story that's worth telling and retelling 6 weeks out of the year, 52 weeks out of the year, that our God raised from the dead. Not as a ghost, not as some kind of rerun story, not in a way that makes us think, well, this life doesn't matter at all. No, in a way that invites us in to take Christ's extended hand and follow him into a resurrected life. Because Christ is risen indeed. Amen.
Will you stand and respond to that great word with the words of the Apostles' Creed 881 in your red hymnal? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Friends, our closing hymn is hymn number 303.
Thank you.
friends, thank you for gathering with us for worship today. Worship is one of those things that's best done together, and so your presence here makes a difference. Thank you for praying, listening, singing. You guys can stand right here. Stay with me, I need you. For worshiping with us. The good news is that all that we felt and experienced here doesn't end here. That's why what our acolytes are doing is so important. They'll bring the light out ahead of us as a reminder that the Holy Spirit is leading us to live lives full of worship, resurrection lives. As you get ready to leave this space, don't feel in a rush. Maybe turn to someone near you and share that good Easter news. Happy Easter, Christ is risen indeed. If you're serving on an administrative board or you want to join us, don't forget that that meeting starts in the chapel at 1. And in the meantime, there's a lunch in the fellowship hall that we can enjoy together. I talked for too long. But friends, as you leave, may the resurrected Christ leave you. May you live in a way that points to life eternal. Amen.
Thank you for joining us in worship today. More information about Central United Methodist Church can be found at centralumc.org. May the peace of Christ be with you as you go about your week.